Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. We're glad to have you with us in this video. Glad that you're watching. Hopefully these things have been a blessing to you. And hopefully you're being encouraged. Even though we're not together, hopefully you're able to still find some sort of fellowship with each other through these different videos. So we do thank God for all he's doing for us. Thank God that we're well, we're safe, and that even though things are a bit different and in many instances chaotic, we're still able to just be blessed by fellowship and by all the things that God is doing for us and through us. So thank God for you. I don't know if everybody's been sent home yet, but they sent me home. So other than coming out here and doing these videos, I don't have many places that, you know, I can go, but hopefully we're all well. And I'm glad that you've taken the time to join us for this installment of studying God's word. So last week or last time we came together, we were talking from the book of Romans, which was a letter from the apostle Paul. And today we're going to look at another letter that Paul wrote, which is the epistle to the church in Ephesus. We call it the book of Ephesians. And I think it's going to be something that will help us greatly, because we are obviously in a position where we're asking the Lord to really, you know, develop us and make us and put us into a position, bring us to a position where we can really be used for his glory. And I don't think that there's any other time in our lifetime than this time that we're in right now that is as important and as necessary as it has been. So I want us to continue to talk through these things for the next couple of weeks or until we get back together, just to keep our minds fresh. You know, I know sometimes it's kind of difficult. We're not able to do what we've always done. And sometimes we can get rather lost, you know, trying to create new ways. But hopefully, as we read through the text and read and go through these means of communication, we'll have something that we can hold on to and actually gives us a new approach to how we ought to live as believers. I never thought that I would be able to say that I'm going to have to exercise my belief in a way that does not involve me frequenting a church building. At least I didn't think that until lately. It took me a while to get this concept together in my mind that church, being the church, is more than gathering in the building. So what I want us to do is look at Ephesians for a moment. I want us to take a look at the book of Ephesians chapter 2. We'll look at verse 8 through verse number 10, and that will serve as a bit of our focus text for this morning. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 through verse number 10, I'll read from the NLT version. It says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. You can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the things or the good things we have done, so no one of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. I want to talk to you on the subject, God's masterpiece. All right, God's masterpiece. That's what I want to talk about this morning. I want to talk about this because if you read through the book of Ephesians, you'll see that there is a premise that Paul is working off of. In other words, Paul has approached the subject that he's dealing with and all the different matters that he will discuss in the book of Ephesians with a particular premise in mind. He has something in the back of his mind that is causing him to write about the various things that he will write about throughout this book. And that premise is really found in the first chapter, where Paul begins to open up what he calls God's mysterious plan. In other words, he has come to the understanding that God sometimes holds secrets. And I know that may be something that we don't like to hear, but sometimes God holds from us what he is doing. I'm praying and I'm asking us to pray as we go through these next 7 days to pray for discernment. Because there are certain things that God wants us to know, because he requires us and expects us to respond a certain way. But the truth of the matter is that God does not tell us everything that we could know. And that has been shown from the very first book of the Bible, where God told Adam and Eve not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that's simply because as human beings, there are only certain things we can know. There are only certain things that God allows us to know, and everything else is for his own knowledge. So when Paul embraces the community in Ephesus and he begins to talk to or write to them about certain things that will encourage them and instruct them, he uses a certain premise that at one point in the world's history, God had a thing in his mind that he was going to do, but he didn't tell anybody about it. He just commanded people to do things, and he put certain things in their spirit, and he allowed them to be moved, or the biblical word for it is inspired, in a way that if they did, or even if they didn't, whatever they did, it would in some way or another, it would lead to this point in which Paul was writing, this point in history and this time that Paul was in, that it's going to actually come out what this big secret was, what it was that God was doing. I want to say this first thing as we move forward, and we'll have three points that we'll bring out later on. But I do want to say this. We should not be discouraged if we don't know everything we want to know about what God is doing in our lives. I think sometimes we give the impression that God is going to download everything into our mind and tell us everything we want to know. And that just isn't the case. What God does, however, is he tells us everything we need to know in order to do what we need to do, in order to bring glory to his name. So I want to encourage everybody to not beat your head against the wall about things that you may not know, but rather focus on what you do know. Focus on what God has revealed to you and accept that. Now, the part of discerning becomes important because whenever God reveals a certain thing to us, it is our duty to discern the good that comes out of complying with what God has revealed that we should be doing. In other words, you have to have a spiritual mind to understand spiritual things. That's why Paul says the flesh, the natural man, cannot accept the spiritual things of God. And that's because there's an incompatibility there. There's a such thing as you trying to mix what you see as a spiritual thing with what God is actually saying is a natural thing. And the two don't mix together. So whenever we consider God and how he works and how he operates in our lives and what that is like, how that feels, what sort of connection should be there, we should always understand that there are moments in our life where we're going to sit back and say, I just don't get that. But what we ought to do in that moment is we ought to grab hold to what God has given us, because there will be a day when we will get it. And that's where Paul is at in this text, where he is actually saying, we have finally come to the point where what was once hidden is no longer hidden anymore. And that requires us to have an even greater responsibility, even greater obligation to God, all right? So he says this in Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 9. He says, God has now revealed to us his mysterious plan regarding Christ, a plan to fulfill his own good pleasure. In other words, God had something he always wanted to do, and he wasn't going to stop until it was done. It just so happened that out of all the people that God had created, even up until this moment, the one person that was expected to actually bring this plan into full manifestation and to accomplish it, Paul is admitting here that that person was Jesus Christ. Now, he tells us what the plan is. He says, and this is the plan at the right time. I want you to underline that in your Bible. In verse number 10, the King James Version translation says a little more conservatively, says that in the dispensation of fullness of times. But what that basically means is that God had an appointed time. And I highlight that because all throughout the Bible, we find that God works on his time. In other words, God has every single thing that he's going to do for you and I mapped out on a particular time scale, and there's nothing really that we can do to speed that up or slow that down. Okay, it is what God's sovereignty looks like. It is that God has things that he does within a particular time frame that he sees as best, and there's nothing, no way, no how we can stop what he is willing to do, what his will is. Now, does that mean that God allows us to do whatever we want and he just goes on and goes on? No, that isn't how it works. What I'm saying to you is that there is something that God has established for you and I. There's some things that he's established for this creation. We shouldn't really overpersonalize that, but more specifically, for the whole creation, God is doing something. And I want us to understand that a time is appointed for its manifestation, which is why it's so important for us to be consistent, be the sort of person that does everything that is needed all the time as a matter of habit, because whenever God reaches that point, we want to be found in the proper place. All right. So at the right time, he will bring everything together under the authority of Christ, everything in heaven and on earth. That's what God wants to do. He wants to do that. Now, how does he do that? He does that with us. Well, as we read earlier, this is where we become very important. We become very important because at this point, we're coming to understand that as God is working all of these things out, he has decided to incorporate us. He has decided to use each one of us as the way in which this whole creational project, this whole renovation of creation is to happen. And he calls us his workmanship, or in a more relevant word for it, his masterpiece. We are God's masterpiece. The Greek word literally means, whenever you look at it, not only are we good in function, but we're good to look at. We are everything. We are the fabric. We are pleasant to the eye. We are durable and functional. Everything about us, it serves a purpose in everything. So whenever Paul refers to the church as the workmanship, what he's saying is that you are that special thing that the world needs. In other words, you are that special ingredient. Kind of like, in many instances, you know, you can cook a very great dish and it may be great, but a lot of great cooks, they can always taste when there's that one thing missing. And when that one thing is dropped in there, then the whole dish becomes all the more pleasant to eat. Well, the world was good, right? The world was made good, but the world was not perfect. The world was not mature. The world could only become mature whenever God would allow that time to come when his son would literally do what he was supposed to do. And in doing that, he has formed a body of people to continue in the way that he had gone, in the way that he had ministered himself as a servant to his father. All right. So we have to look at ourselves that way. And so when we look at this epistle, Paul is bringing this point home over and over again. And what he does is he keeps reminding the church, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you. And there's two things really that he talks about he wants them to receive. The first thing is found in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 15 through verse number 23. He talks about how important and how desirous he is for them to have spiritual wisdom. He wants them to have spiritual wisdom. He doesn't pray for any other thing. And what I mean by that, it's not going in an element of a whole list of laundry list of things. Everything he prays for in this epistle is spiritual. And that is because Paul has already set the foundation for them to understand we are a part of something bigger than ourselves. I'll say this. Our prayers will only be focused on us and what we can do for ourselves when we are not cognitive of the fact that we are a part of something that's bigger than us. All right. You learn to change your prayers whenever you understand God has incorporated you into something that is far bigger than yourself. If you ever want your prayers to become better, if you ever want your prayers to get answered, I would submit to you to think of yourself as being a part of something bigger than you. Think of yourself as being a part of the God project, the renovative program of which God restores the world. And then pray through that mindset, that perspective, that understanding. And then you'll see how greatly your prayers are answered. So when we look at Ephesians chapter 2, the one thing that he prays for here is spiritual wisdom. In other words, we need something inside of us that would give us the ability to have insight, clarity, knowledge, understanding, that we may have this understanding of the hope that God has given us through Jesus Christ. So then he goes into the next chapter, or chapter 4, and he starts to pray again. And his prayer this time is for spiritual growth. He wants them to have understanding. He wants them to know about how deep this love that Christ has for us really is. He wants us not only to just know it or understand it, but he wants us to grow in it. He wants us to live day by day, experiencing more of this relationship with God. I want to say this to us. If we're going to be God's masterpiece, right, we have to put in our mind that every day has to be a pursuit for Jesus Christ. In other words, just because we're saved, we're not saying by any means, I have gotten Jesus Christ. Yes, we may have him, but the solution to our day-to-day living, the problems that we experience from day to day, the things we are running into on a consistent basis, the solution to all of that is having a life so deeply in pursuit of Jesus Christ that all these other things don't have room to congest your thoughts, your thinking, and your desires, okay? So when we look at what Paul is praying for, he's doing this because he understands that it is a matter of us understanding our value and how our value, it works within the overall plan of God, all right? So those two things are very important. Now, I want to give you three things that I think will help you in understanding how we can develop our role as the masterpiece of God, how we can be more effective, how life can be a lot more peaceful and full of joy. Here are three things that we can do to help in this endeavor. The first thing is we should renew our thoughts and attitudes. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 23, really what Paul is telling us is not so much to take an effort to change and discipline our thoughts and attitudes, because really in many respects, that's rather hard, if not impossible, to do. We have a hard time controlling our thoughts because we are so sensitive to things that are closest to what we value, all right? If something rubs our valuables the wrong way, or the things that we value, it's going to automatically affect our attitude and our thoughts. But instead of Paul saying, renew your thoughts and attitudes, what he says is, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. In other words, I can be no more positive than what I would allow the Spirit to help me be, all right? It's not that we can't be positive. It's that we must allow the Spirit to help us be positive, because as much as we try to maintain a positive mindset, we get distracted. We get kind of bombarded by life. So Paul's advice here is let the Spirit renew your thoughts and your attitudes. Let him give you a new perspective, a new idea, a new concept for living, a new approach, a new strategy. Let him control your thinking, all right? This is a part of us growing, all right, and having that sense of a spiritual existence. That's what it's all about. Not just the ritualistic, you know, sometimes in many respects, I'm kind of happy for this moment because it really teaches us how important it is to have this personal, intimate relationship with God that is between him and us. We are with him and he is with us on a personal level and on a very realistic, true, and authentic level, all right? So that's one thing we can do. Allow the Spirit to renew our thoughts and our attitudes. The next thing we can do is figure out what pleases God, all right? This is something that we should be in daily pursuit of, discovering more of God and figuring out, what can I do to please him? What is the thing that makes God most happy? All right, that's a good question to ask. And that's a good question to answer. You shouldn't just ask it, but try to answer that. Ask yourself right now, what do I do? What can I do that will make the Lord the most happiest? All right. And when you figure that out, you're beginning to live in that role of a unique masterpiece for the Lord. Here's the last thing. The last thing is believe God can do anything. Now, when you put yourself in a position to allow God to change your attitude and your thoughts, and then you get into a position where you allow God in many respects to renew your inner being, and you begin to comply yourself with his desire and his will, then you put yourself in a position where you're saying, I have to believe God for anything. Let me tell you why that's important. Whenever you live this sort of life as a masterpiece, as God's masterpiece, you literally put yourself in a position to be vulnerable, and you take yourself out of the care of your own self. In other words, you deny the idea that I can do it for myself. You put yourself in a position to be vulnerable and be open to attacks that you on your own would try to prevent. So whenever we take this sort of position in life, we have to do what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 through verse number 21. We have to, after we have this mindset of prayer, we have to give this sort of praise to God, declaring, I know the one that can do exceedingly and abundantly above all I can ever ask or think. You have to believe that. You have to say to yourself, there is a reason to praise him because he's able to exceed my request, exceed my thinking. And when you do that, you're saying to yourself, I believe God is going to take care of me in this submission to his will and to his great desire to reveal himself. So I want us to be encouraged. I want us to say to ourselves, we are part of something big. We're part of something that requires us to, I want to say it this way, change. But in doing that, we are securing our future. We are securing our ability to live in this world and to live in this peace that surpasses all understanding. I want that for all of us. But now is the time to devote yourself and recognize your worth, not for your own selfish endeavors, but really for what you're doing for the name of God and how that impacts not just you, but the entire world. All right. Like I said on Wednesday, now is our time to stand up because God is, he is watching us. He is really trying to get our attention. And it is our job to prepare ourselves for the revival and for the work that the Lord will do in this time. So I thank God for you. I hope this has helped in some way, form, or fashion. I look forward to seeing you all again. But until then, we'll keep communicating by this means. I just want to encourage everybody to be safe and to be watchful, be obedient, and be spiritual. Be as spiritual as you possibly can. Let's say a prayer real quick as we close out this particular study. God, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for your wisdom. And we just want to appreciate your ability to see past the moment. How from the very first days you saw the day in which we would be praying this prayer. And you knew that we wouldn't have this access unless Jesus would come and do what he needed to do on our behalf. And we are so thankful that he did that. He did what he needed to do. He made all things right. And because of it, we're here before your holy throne right now. We ask you, Lord God, to bless us the weeks ahead. Give us clarity, give us understanding, and give us everything we need to become more like you, because that's our heart's desire. We thank you for all that you would do for us. Thank you for the blessing that we will receive throughout this week. It's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Let us all say amen. All right, guys, you have a blessed week. Lord willing, we'll catch up with you soon. Y'all take care.